I'm Andrew Norton, I'm Director of Why Ideas. What a pleasure to be here. Many thanks to everyone. I think this is the fourth D&C Days I've been at the Trolls. It's been really good, and there's also a sense of building knowledge, accumulating knowledge, building a community that can work together. I feel more than it currently does in between these meetings as well. So let's make that a theme for tomorrow. Now, this session, I was originally asked to do reflections. Didn't really feel like that because I've seen about 30-40% of what's gone on today. So I thought instead that we would try to gather together some thoughts and take them into tomorrow, and drawing on everyone's experience in the room of the day. So this is fairly simple, two questions. Think of one of the themes, either resilience through empowerment, lived experience of local knowledge, transparency and downward accountability to the local level, to the base, or financing, adaptation, managing risks. So one of those things, one of the tracks for the 2 days. Address these two questions, and I want you to think about these for about 5 minutes, and then we'll gather in a few thoughts, and if you have other thoughts, you can give them to Claire, who's up there, and we'll take them into tomorrow. So this is stuff, particularly the second question: what are the intractable, wiki, knotty problems that are at the back of your head, and you're thinking, well, yeah, well, this is fine, but what are those? What can we take into tomorrow and think about that would move us forward? So two things then. Is there a standout lesson, something you can apply in your work, something useful, something you heard and you went, wow, that's really useful, I should capture that and think about it? What's the standout lesson, but something applicable, something practical? And the second question, what should we be challenging ourselves to solve tomorrow? Again, if you could pick one of the themes and think about those two, and take about 5 minutes and think of something, and we'll just do show of hands afterwards, but gather in any other ideas that we don't get to. So, if you could take 5 minutes and think about those two questions. Thanks. Who wants to pick out one or two, either lessons or challenges to solve tomorrow, but make it clear which it is you're saying? Pablo.
Thank you. Sorry, I lost my voice, and I hope you can understand me. Mostly because of something that Noel said that then materialized in the Theater of the Oppressed session. But I was really struck that empowerment sounds like you lack power, we can give you power, let's give you power. But instead, there seems to be, like, the protesters not being allowed into Poland. There's people who already have the ability to manifest their abilities, including power. There is a process of deliberately trying to remove the power from them to disempower. And what we need to do is to undisempower, to remove the barriers, etc. It's, I don't know what wording to come up with, but it's beginning to sound more like a form of activism that our community doesn't feel comfortable with. Yeah. So it's challenging ourselves. How can we recognize that it's becoming a different beast?
So recognizing the way the world's changing, and that our technocratic languages that we apply to something like power are rapidly becoming redundant. Something like that, what do we do about that? Yeah, that's great. Thanks for that. Any other thoughts on resilience through empowerment? Either things you lessons to take away or challenges to think about in the day tomorrow, to address in the day tomorrow?
Yeah, I mean, I sort of to build on what people are saying, I think the word power is really important, and I think this, maybe we've come now with the D&C days to a position where we're wondering, well, I'm wondering, having been to previous ones a while ago, thinking, well, what position, what role does this group play? And I was think about how Celine used to say, well, hang on, what we're saying in this room is not making it to the ears of the negotiators. But I'm wondering now if we're actually the right ones to be speaking to negotiators, and whether we're sort of elite here with power, and we think, because we have knowledge, And how we position ourselves vis-a-vis the people who aren't powered on the ground, who don't get to speak and don't have the voices and get to come to the calls.
So again, it's about learning to work with the way the world is changing through my in terms of our position as a group that work on these things from, I don't know if I'd describe this as an elite, but certainly as a technical group or whatever working around these things, a community. Great, thanks very much. I'm going to move to the second one now, value for lived experience and local knowledge. Again, either a takeaway lesson that you can apply in your work or a really knotty, a problem, issue that you want us to come back to tomorrow. This is the lived experience track.
Thank you. We had an interesting discussion in our session about local knowledge and participation and how actually participation itself is incredibly important. It's incredibly difficult to get right. It shouldn't be a box-ticking exercise, but the process of participation itself can also be very disempowering. People have to stand up, people have to put their views forward, and they might get castigated for their later, tortured, possibly even killed. So we have to deal with that issue very carefully.
Yeah, it's in the same space really, the way the world is changing, and the way that space for free expression is closing down really rapidly in a lot of places, not everywhere, in some way, arguably some places can do that, but something to think about in terms of how we engage. So again, a challenge to come back to tomorrow, I think. Well, I'm moving now, transparency and downward accountability. Again, I think a lot of the discussions in that area have also been linked to finance, which we'll come to in a minute. But again, either a lesson or a challenge to come back to tomorrow. Salim.
I thought that was an excellent session, particularly the focus on downward accountability. My sense is that perhaps we are confining ourselves too much to the monitoring and evaluation as a technocratic modality, and not enough emphasis on learning as a very, very important part, which is from the bottom up. It is people actually doing things, learning by doing, that we from outside try and evaluate, but don't value their knowledge. And I think it's a challenge for us to do that. And if I might also reflect on the conversation we had on empowerment, I think in a very, very real sense, the Paris Agreement has actually disempowered the negotiators and empowered us here. We are now the actors. We can implement the Paris Agreement. We don't need their permission. We don't need their words and text. It doesn't matter what they write or what they agree. It's agreed. The implementation is agreed. We are implementers. We can just go ahead and forge the agreement, the Paris Agreement implementation ourselves, and not think about we must influence negotiators. Let's forget doing that. Thank you.
Thanks, Salim. Anyone else with some thoughts on transparency and accountability? I mean, a lot of what we're getting is in a very similar space. It's about the way the world is changing. And agency is, we're seeing it much more in different places, coming from the bottom up. But there are still risks, obviously huge risks, around political changes in the world at the moment. Okay, the final one, financing, adaptation and managing risk. Wants to have a go at either a takeaway lesson or a challenge for tomorrow.
Thanks a lot. In fact, I was asking Mr. Wittier how bring on board, especially the private sector. And when you look at the case for Africa, adaptation is a priority. Something is happening at the community level. Communities are engaging in terms of doing business also to facilitate or to earn income. But in this room, if I ask, and what the case for, especially the case for Nepal, as a good case, how do we bring on board the medium and small, medium enterprises and microfinancing institutions, which are growing, especially in developing countries, to invest in adaptation strategies? That is something that I've not found out the solution, that I've not found anybody who can concretely tell us, as African Center for Technology Studies in Kenya, we are coordinating the African State Climate Action Network, which we launched 2 months ago, to provide an opportunity for the private sector and the CPOs and the universities and sub-national governments to come and dialogue. So how do we really support them to understand and manage the risks associated with advancing climate funding to the community-based initiatives? Thank you.
Thanks very much. That was something in the finance sessions that I was in that came up a lot. Bringing together, finding ways of integrating SMEs into climate adaptation action. So thanks very much for that.
I guess you have to forgive me if I use some sort of D&C Days kind of words, but in the two sessions that I was in on data and then also on risk and peace building and conflict areas, the kind of threads that went through both of those were actually about being creative and being accessible and listening. So I think it was kind of, you know, talking to people on the ground, talking to people who are working at the top, acknowledging their complexities across all of the discussions, and be accessible and accept that there are differences, but we have to kind of come to, not agreement, but discussion, ongoing. Feel free to disagree with me, anybody who's in one session.
Thanks, sir. Just a final thought from me, coming back to the great sessions earlier in the day, Deborah Roberts really focused and thoughtful and careful presentation of the main findings of the 1.5 report, distilling it really into these key areas. The most important thing, she said, was this step change or transformation or transition in basically lowering emissions rapidly in urban infrastructure, land, energy, and what's the fourth one? There were four areas, sorry, one's just gone out. But and then there was Claire's comments as well about the step change that we need from business as usual in relation to the resilience piece, bringing development and climate action together in the adaptation space. I mean, my sense from the developed climate-based community is that there is something that comes together every year that's valuable, that brings thoughts together, that does build knowledge, and each year you get a sense of knowledge accumulating and of, you know, solutions being found and improvements being made in the way we work. So my ask for tomorrow would be to think about can we up our game? Can we do something to make that step change more material and more real by thinking about maintaining the kind of communication that we get in this community once a year through the year? So that would be my problem, my issue and challenge to take into tomorrow. Thank you all very much.